Hi, here's Roshaka from the Scorpions, and you're listening to La Grosse Radio Rock and Roll! First of all, when we announced the farewell tour, we thought and we were very serious because we did an album called Sting in the Tail, which was excellent done, and especially our manager said, hey guys, how you want to make an album like this? We said, yeah, sure, that's a good question, you know. In this case, Klaus and me were already 61 and we wasn't sure whether we repeat this and we still in shape. We were afraid that we coming in a situation that we running behind us, that we can't give the people what they are known from us. Uh-huh. So in this case, before we coming in a situation, we want to go forward. We said, okay, everything has its time and let's make the farewell tour. So, but in the farewell tour, also when we announced it, we had in mind that we do some projects. We didn't know what kind of projects. We know that we want to do a bonus track album for a giveaway for the people, for the fans, or say thank you very much for your whole career and for all this kind of things. But when we came into the position to start the farewell tour, we were overwhelmed by the ticket sales, by the success, and we were completely, and especially from the fans who came to the airport crying and bringing flowers and so, oh, why are you stopping? And you know, we start knowing, we start seeing what we mean to the fans. So in this case, we, by going into the situation that we had this Facebook situation coming up, mm-hmm. and we 6.5 million, 80% of this are between 16 and 28. 80% of these people. I mean, we thought, and we could see also in front of the stage, the young kids singing Blackout when they even weren't born, when this were composed. So in this case, we said, oh, that's unbelievable. So, but then when we came, we were in the end of 2012, and when we played in Munich, we thought we'd let it be like very take it easy in 2013 to go maybe on vacation, have a good time and enjoy living. And I'm still enjoying being on stage too, but somehow, you know, you're coming to the point where you being in the rotation of doing things again and again. And then MTV called us in January and said, you know, we this unplugged thing. We didn't say no because it was a challenge for us, especially with our new producers. And also by working before MTV Unplugged to do this album Come Black, to bring this young kids this possibility, because our back catalog was not available, to give the young kids the possibility to buy the stuff like Blackout, like No One Like You, like Rocker, like Hurricane, and with a new technology. So in this case, we were on the point where we said, okay, now 2013 done, the MTV Unplugged was released in 90 countries around the world, and we were very happy also with that success. We start working again on the bonus track album, and by really going through the tapes and old material and stuff like this, I noticed the mess in my office, in my guitar room, you know, and I said, look, I want to change it, I want to clean up the things, and I can't find this and this and this. But anyway, then some people put all the stuff from the corners into the middle of the room and stuff. So, and then by one moment I was opening the window and looking downstairs, I see a book open up like that. And I said, what's that? That was the book my mother did in the beginning when I was looking, when I was building up a band. Of course, you need equipment. Where are you getting money from? So my father said, okay, guys, I like when you guys making music. Here, it's the money. We go and let's shopping. So, and we bought the equipment, and my father was not into, let's say, getting money back, but my mother, she was more in the situation, no, you have to appreciate what you got here, you have to, we do one thing, I make a book, income, splitting half, we pay the money back from the equipment, and the other part is for your pocket money. So in this case, I saw this book on the floor, on the ground. It started in the end of September of 1965. I went down to my friends in the studio. I said, hey guys, what I found here, look, next year is 50 years. Our manager said, what? That's unbelievable. I have to call the promoters. I have to ask what they think about for the Scorpions celebrating 50 years. You have to do that because, you know, there's not many bands. The Who, the Stones, the Beach Boys. That's the only. And you guys coming from Germany, you have. And you ask the promoters there. We said, hey, amazing. Yeah, we are there and we can do this and this. Then I said, look, guys, we can't do the farewell tour, the 50 years anniversary tour without a new album. So, and then we came in a position to listen back to the bonus track stuff, and we saw, we could hear how good the stuff was already. And then we said, okay, we have to write some new stuff, and we start writing new stuff. And what actually was good about the whole thing was that because of working on the old material to change maybe choruses, change the lyrics, we had very much connection to the old days by hearing the song called Catch Your Luck and Play, which was called before Bite of the Snake. You know, we said, oh no, the chorus is not good, let's change it and make this chorus in. We were so much connected to this old sound and this Scorpions vibe, including our two our producers who came from Sweden, who working with us since 2009. The one guy, Mikael Lund Andersen, he was growing up in north of Sweden. One of his first albums was In Trance. He became a Scorpions fan and he knew the DNA of the Scorpions. And then we start really doing and getting like a puzzle the old and new stuff together and changing lyrics, talking about the 50 years of rock, Catch Your Luck and Play, and Gypsy Life, and all this kind of thing. That holds us together. Yeah, what can we do? We had every week another album title, talking to the record company. What do you think about this? What do you think about this? And they went crazy until one of the record company guys called and said, look guys, I have a good title for you. Why are you not calling this album Return to Forever? I said, oh, yeah, good. Fits perfectly with our film called Forever and the Day. In this case, perfect thing, you know, if time is right, the whole thing goes together like a puzzle. So working on this new album, including a bonus track, was really a good situation by going through the old material, building new material, to come up with an album which has now already, with our reviews, great success. Yeah, because it's the best song. I mean, for me, it was the best song anyway, already. But the record company, we always leave things open to for decision for a record company because they have to present it. And sometimes they have, especially for this kind of things, a better ear than us. We're going things from a different side. In this case, the record company came up with ours. And I was the same way. I said, right decision. Because it's the perfect, perfect rock song. And the good thing what I like on this song is it starts with a great, okay, with the intro, Scorpions like, then going into the verse, going into the bridge, which sounds like a chorus. But then you're going in the re-chorus. In this case, it's fantastic. It's one of my favorite songs, and also Rock My Car, which is one of the older ones, which I did because by going longer tours in America, worldwide, going by limos, by plane, and by bus, you know, I like to drive cars, you know, In this case, when I come home, I went immediately in my sports car and was driving like crazy on the motorway to 80-300 and rocking the street. And there came the idea, rock my car, push the pedal down to the metal. Yeah. So in this case, it was inspired by life, touring finished. Now, you know, rock the street and make speed. One thing actually, because I'm meditating a lot, doing yoga, I'm very into the philosophy, Indian philosophy, Eastern philosophy, and I'm supposed to live the day. You know, you can't do anything on 2 days. That's yesterday and tomorrow. Uh-huh. And the only day you can do something is now.
Yeah.
So that means I was always, when I was injected by this scorpion sting, which I put by myself in my back because of the Beatles and Rolling Stones, I was so hypnotized by this dream of good musicians here, but 4 or 5 friends traveling around the world and making music, that I was so really focused into that, that time was not existing. So in this case, I was living every day like it was the last. And in this case, now, on the 7th, we had our premiere for the film. I was going through the history again. And then I didn't notice how long it was. Before not. Before one thing came after the other. Okay, sometimes you had a problem, but problems are there to overtake them. So in this case, I noticed then, Mamma Mia. What kind of life, what kind of really outstanding way to live. And I think that's the great thing. And it was like everything was taken together like a puzzle. The farewell tour, MTV Unplugged, then we start doing this film. The film had a little change, life changed it a little bit. Then going into the 50 years, it's like a perfect... a perfect way of slowing down later on our career, because it's an unbelievable, outstanding career. Nobody was thinking that a career like the Scorpions could be this long, you know. And I know, I remember when I was 24 around, people are still asking, hey, what's happening? What are you doing? You're still doing music? I say, yes. Hey, stop dreaming. What do you want to do when you are 30? Oh, you know, I'm still here doing what I like to do. And that's, I think, is a very important point of living. Believe in yourself, do what you feel. Not doing it for the money, do it because you love it. And that's the only way you can really enjoy life and look then back and say, yeah, I did everything right. So what can I say? I'm enjoying and I'm living and I'm healthy, more healthy than some other people who lived a normal life. I was living in an unnormal, unusual life, and I'm very happy that I'm still healthy and rock still. So much, and I was very much connected to Radio Monte Carlo, because when I was a kid, I was always, my father and mother went for dancing. I was going to the living room and I was going through the radio and was looking for the radio stations. And Radio Monte Carlo was my favorite radio station. That's the reason why I'm Mikhail Polnareff, Johnny Hallyday, François Hardy, François Gall, all this kind of French artists I know because of Radio Monte Carlo. But Radio Monte Carlo was also playing a real rock and roll from America, like Elvis Presley, Little Richard. In this case, I was ready. The first time I was outside of Germany was with my parents in Monte Carlo. The first thing I said, look guys, we are not in the right way here. This music we don't want to play like crowd rock, we want to play real rock. Let's go to France. And I was very inspired by the French girls, by the French atmosphere, by the French club Les Bon Douches, Le Locomotive, and all this kind of thing. The first time I met Elisa Messrich, Melissa Etheridge, you know, as a singer. She is American, and I met her in La Locomotive and had a party because her birthday party was there. And you know, I was running into was Lenny Kravitz, but I didn't know at this time. He asked me for an autograph that this was Lenny Kravitz. He came to me and said, "Can you sign me?" I said, "Yeah, okay." So, and then a few years later, we had this English awards to do in 1990. And we had to go by Concorde from America to get the award, sing, play a song. I played even with Bo Diddley and with two guys from Faith No More. Mm-hmm. We played My Generation in front of us. Pete Townsend was sitting with his family. So, and I remember that I lost the point. We came from where? And then we had to fly back by Concorde.
Yeah.
One guy came to me. Hey, how are you? And I was really thinking, who is this guy? Because this was in the beginning of his career.
Yeah.
And Klaus came around the corner and said, hello, Lenny. Lenny. So, and then I noticed, this was the guy. And then he came and said, yeah, Rudolf, you know why I'm playing Flying V? Because of you. You inspired me. So this kind of situation, and this was Paris. Paris was really taking us, he's a woman, she's a man, is inspired by Paris. You know, he's a woman, she's a man.
He's a woman, spoken, she's a man, taken by force.
Yeah. Yes, it's the Herman, Klaus and me, we were from Montreal. So, and there, three chicks came on the car. We were with a 350 SEL, Mercedes driving. And we, hey, girls, what's up? Yeah. Then one girl came in and said, sorry, we are guys. So I said, okay. And then Herman came up with the idea, he's own shit. Anyway, so many connections to French and to Paris. That's the point. And that's also because that could be the possibility that my whole wish to write a great ballad, an outstanding ballad, was inspired by France. Mm-hmm. So that's maybe the reason also that I think it's the most sold single ever in France. So let's roll. I remember that we had a fantastic time, it's an amazing festival. And when we got the offer, we said immediately yes, because it's really one of the festivals. We can connect it very strongly to Wacken. You know, it's a very, we are always, you know, sometimes we sounding maybe a little bit, for some hard rockers, a little bit la-la-la something, you know. But I think it's, we are lucky to have both sides. I have respect for AC/DC. They're playing their blues and their stuff very straight on forward. But our possibilities, because of Klaus as a singer, he has so much possibilities in his vocals. It would be terrible to miss this part he has on this side. In this case, we have enough guts, enough balls to say, okay, we can play this, but we can also play this. We are rockers outside, but with a very, very sensitive heart. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the best thing you can have. In this case, we want to also give it for the people, music-wise, and that's the way Scorpion style is. And we are completely like it, and we also like to play Hellfest, because then we can really play rock like hell.
Hey, what's up? This is Michael Starr.
This is Lexi Fox.
And you're listening to La Grosse Radio with Steel Panther, man.
Wow.
One of the hardest rocking bands from America. You know what? We're never going to stop rocking. You know why? Because we fucking love heavy metal and we love pussy.
Well, feels good to me. I don't know about you.